What's going on? You got the almighty DJ CJ Flash back with a brand new live episode of I Remember That Song. Here to tell you all about it is the man, the myth, the legend, Mr. Jerry Dove.
CJ Flash, Dominus, Ominous.
Ominous.
Go in peace, my son. How are you doing tonight?
Go in peace, my son. I'm doing fantastic, brother. How are you?
I'm good, man. I'm blessed. Blessed and highly favored.
As always. That's a beautiful thing. A beautiful place to be.
Yes, indeed. As opposed to the opposite. You know,
unblessed and unhighly favored.
we'll leave it at that. I was gonna say something else, but we're gonna stay out the news. We're just gonna leave it right there. Okay. Are we gonna have a good time tonight? You ready?
Oh yeah, I'm ready.
Last week we had a great show with Jesse Johnson. If you guys missed that one, you got to go back to the YouTube page and check out Jesse. I wouldn't say that we interviewed him as much as we listened to him.
Right.
And he was great, telling some great stories. Uh-huh. I know our guest tonight is going to tell some great stories too, but let's bring the family in first before we get started. So here we go. Here's Miss Ryan Nicole.
What's up?
Mr. Russell Gaywood. Hey. D-Minor's here too. He told me he'd be right back. So we'll, he's at work. So how's everybody doing? Y'all looking good?
Doing good. Glad to not be cursed and salty flavored.
That is the opposite of...
It's opposite. What's the highly flavored? Cursed and salty flavored.
Salty flavored. I don't think I've ever heard that used in a sentence before, man.
All the spices in the world.
Yes, you have. Just heard it just now.
Just salty. Now. See, that's why you are a poet,
and I don't even know it.
Yeah, wordstress, word master, meister, something like that.
In the words of Moneypenny, a cunning linguist.
And that's I'm gonna leave it at that. That's all I do.
For all you James Bond fans out there, that's it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well done.
Shout out to Moneypenny. There's a black Moneypenny now.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Who's playing? Because it was Angela Lansbury the last time.
Wow.
The murder she wrote with the not Angela Lansbury.
Okay. It was the older white English lady.
Angela Lansbury from Kansas City. What you talking about?
Oh, my bad.
It was actually the secretary from the Beverly Hillbillies. That's what it was actually.
Oh wow! What's her name? No.
What was her last name? The one who had a crush on. She had a crush on Jethro.
Jethro.
Miss Jane.
Yeah, Miss
Jane. You guys don't know. It was Angela.
Anyway.
It was not.
We got lost for a second.
The new Moneypenny. She is the one who was Oscar nominated for. I forgot the name of the movie.
Angela Lansbury.
We'll go with that. We figured out we'll go with that. Although they did say Nancy Cartwright. That's not
Nancy Cartwright.
No.
No, it wasn't her.
Her name is Jane. Miss Jane. I know that. I don't remember last name.
Yes, okay.
But I...
She was also a tenant at the Sanford Arms.
She was. She was Hoppy's mom's.
Yes, that's right.
She was Hoppy's mom's. She sure was. And then she became a tenant later on.
It goes to show we're not good. We're not going to do well on Family Feud, y'all.
If that question is on there, brother, we don't need to be on Family Feud.
We lost. That's true. It's not Steve Harvey's Family Feud. How about that? Yes.
We're on Family Feud.
Right.
Oh my goodness. Y'all look good on TV. That's what he always tells them when they lose. Y'all look good on TV.
Y'all look good on TV.
Next time, man. All right, but look, hey, you know, let's refocus and get our show going.
All right.
Our guest might just leave. She didn't call, you know, here talk all this madness.
I know.
Or maybe she jumped right in. I don't know. We'll see what
she probably knows the answer.
Maybe she's an answer. got the answer. She's had time to look it up. Maybe she got the answer for us. But, you know, March is Women's History Month, and we're continuing to celebrate the great artists who provided a soundtrack for our lives, whether they know it or not. Audrey Wheeler Downing has been singing since she was a child. She and two of her sisters formed a singing group called the Wheeler Girls and performed in all the school talent shows. At 14, she convinced her mom to allow her to join a local band. Now, after hearing Audrey sing Chaka Khan's Sweet Thing, Moms was moved to tears. Hold that thought, because in a full circle moment, Audrey began singing with the one and only Chaka and has been a band member since 1990. How about that? I wrote most of that. I took a little bit from her bio, so I cheated on my report a little bit, but I wrote most of that. So yeah. Let's see what she thinks when we bring in Miss Audrey Wheeler down in.
Hey,
how you doing?
I'm so glad to be here. Laughing already. Thank you.
Already. Okay. You're welcome. Hopefully you're laughing with us and not at us.
Yes, not at you.
Well, most importantly, do you have the answer for us?
I don't. I'm sitting there laughing at you guys. No.
It's not on Black Jeopardy. We don't know.
We're not going to get on Steve. We ain't going to make it on Steve. Even though we watch Steve Hart. We watch it every night.
Family. Yeah. Oh, yeah. See, you might win. We might need you as the trump card for that.
I might be able to help you.
Yeah, our ace in a hole.
You'll be our phone a friend.
Yeah.
The first person comes down to get like 179 points, and then the next person comes down and chokes it all away.
Right.
Don't you hate that? You feel bad for him.
You do. Like,
you get $5 for every point. Keep it moving.
You're doing so good.
You know?
There we go.
Okay. All right. How are you, Audrey?
I'm okay.
Thank you for joining us from the East Coast.
I'm actually home for a spell, so that's okay. Great. Yeah.
Okay, right, I know you've been on the road. We're going to talk all about all the places you've been and the people you've been with, and we're just happy that you're here. CJ Flash is up there with you. He's going to guide us on the musical tour. Our friends on the bottom row, Big Russ, Ryan Nicole, and D Minor are going to chip in, and I got a few thoughts as well. So you just feel free to let your hair down and have some fun. You're with your family right now, okay?
Thank you.
I already got a question. She said, I'm home for a spell. So where are you from originally?
I'm from Queens, Jamaica, Queens, New York.
You said home for a spell.
Well, I'm in Jersey, but I'm saying I just came home literally 2 days ago.
Oh, wow.
From ATL. Okay. Yeah. Wow.
So you had to be in Atlanta or somewhere in the South.
Atlanta. That's right.
There you go. Okay. Got it.
A spell.
Got influenced. Yeah, got influenced in the language. Yeah. Yes.
Well, before we get rolling, let's let Ryan and Cole say hello to everybody out there and have them join us. You ready, Ryan?
Yes, I was ready.
You ready for your close-up?
Yeah, I am, Mr. Jameer. Hey, what's happening, everybody? IRTS Live, you are here. Hello, everybody. Very good to see you. We are on IRTS Live, and you are here with us. You may be on Facebook. You may be on YouTube. You may be on Twitter. You may be on Instagram, because those are all the places that we are. We are also on Roku on SoulTVWatch.com. So if you are there with us, we are here with you on Soul TV or any of the other platforms. We're so glad that you're with us. You know what to do. Like, subscribe, and share. Come on, everybody. Say it with me now. Like subscribe. And share.
And share.
That's right. That's right. So those are your three major to-dos. And since you are here, you're yet with us, please put your name in the chat. Let us know where you are, where you're from, all of that. I know we see folks from all over the world, so we love to know where you are right now, where you're joining us from. So do that after you tell a friend to come on over and join us while we talk to Miss Wheeler Downing.
Okay. Let's say hello to who's out there in the audience already. My man Vince Robinson says it's Nancy Culp.
Yes.
Her name. You know, one other thing, she ran for some kind of a Senate or something.
Y'all just keep making stuff up.
I'm not making that up. Vince, look it up. She ran for Congress or something like that. She was as a Republican back in the day from somewhere in the Midwest. Wow.
And she invented the tropical blueberry Kool-Aid flavor.
She was the first woman to put Pop Rocks in Coca-Cola.
Right.
She could have been. Okay. Say hello to Crystal. It's in Virginia Beach, Virginia.
What's up, Crystal?
Kyle Newport, somebody we all know.
I won't sell it. Won't
sell it. Okay.
It's the mustache.
Oh, Audrey. That's hilarious. You call him that? That's great.
That's a good one right now and then. my good friend Latisse is in Los Angeles. Hey, you see Kim Batiste right up here.
Hey, welcome.
Hey, Kim.
New York City. Somebody's calling us from New York.
That's right.
From Bay Area, New York City.
New York City.
Hey.
That's where I'm from.
Okay. All right. So let's go. So Audrey, you were singing when you were a child, and your mom didn't understand that you had this gift, or what you had to convince her. What happened?
So I'm one of eight, first of all.
First you had to get her attention then, right?
Exactly. I'm like, there's no middle of eight, but I'm the middle, pretty much.
Okay.
And she didn't really know. They didn't find out until my brother had like a music system in the basement, and I would put his headphones on and be singing out loud, not knowing that the whole family would, like, I'd open my eyes and they would all be standing down there like, we didn't know you could sing, you know. And I would be embarrassed and like, oh, you know, like stop singing immediately. And then there was a neighbor next door, his wife was doing a cotillion and she wanted me to be in it. And that was, I was probably about 10, 11, 12 when they first heard me sing. And they knew, but you know, they weren't, my mother was a nurse, my father worked for United. They were like, you're not gonna do this for your job. You know, that's really cute that you like to sing, but what's your real job gonna be? Mm-hmm. So yeah, so she didn't know until when I got about 14, a girlfriend of mine was like, we're gonna be in this band. And my dad was like, are there gonna be boys there? I was like, yeah. He said, oh, you can't do it then. What? So my mother snuck and she let me do it. And there was another little girl with me, and my father didn't. She didn't even tell him I did a performance. And of course, strangely, I sang A Sweet Thing. And my mother was sitting there, and she was wiping tears, and she was just like, everybody was crying. I had no idea you could sing. Mm-hmm. And that's what softened it up a little bit more, where they were more open. Their whole thing was they had five girls, and, you know, boys, they were like, boys are in the band? Oh, no, you're not gonna be in the band.
Forget about it.
So, and my dad would say it with a straight face, like, oh. The boys in the band? Oh,
you're
not doing that.
No. He meant it.
Oh, yeah. And they were scared of my father, too, in the neighborhood anyway, because my dad was a, you know, kind of a big guy.
Right.
In basketball. So they were like, they knew. Those Wheeler girls, you might not want to. Have you seen the father? You know, my brothers are kind of tall, too, now. So, you know, we were close-knit family. So I'm the only one that really kind of took that on. I have one other sister who could sing as well, but she didn't do it professionally.
Your father played basketball?
Yeah, they did, actually. My brother, one of my brothers, Bill Wheeler, played for Manhattan. He almost was on the Charlotte Hornets, you know, so my dad, you know, it's a basketball family. Trust me, I have a nephew who's playing in the B League. So it's a big basketball family.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
So who's your team? You're from back east, so who's your team? You're Knicks or Nets?
I'm a Knicks fan. My husband is a Nets fan.
I
haven't followed the Knicks in so long. I do love basketball, but we were just watching it earlier. So, you know,
this is the year to get on them because the Knicks are doing a whole lot better than the Nets. So now's the time for you jump on the bandwagon, Audrey.
But they move players so much. Just when you get, you know, you like somebody, next thing you know, it's like, what, they traded?
That's true.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's my problem.
You'd be better off, you know, following the college kids right now. It's a good time for that.
And we do watch that too. But we really watch tennis. We're into tennis.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Coco. Yes.
You guys are on the same squad with that, right?
Yes.
Good deal.
You know, our main girl has retired. You know,
yes, Miss Serena.
But, you know, we're going with Coco a little bit right now. And, you know, Shelton, we try to hang with the United States players, but whatever.
Nice. You guys get out to the U.S. Open since you're over on the East Coast?
We used to. I have a girlfriend who used to work for CBS. Uh-huh. So she would get us incredible tickets and like crazy seats. And when you see it in person, you're like, you know, you don't realize how fast it is. So, we used to go every year.
Nice.
And then I became really popular with friends. Like, hey. Like,
right.
Because the thing about it would be that she would call, like, at 10 o'clock and say, I got some tickets for the 11 o'clock. It's like, what?
Oh wow.
So, you know, because we weren't 9-to-5ers, we could just throw our clothes on and
right
go away to Queens. But you know, all my friends started being really "Hey, girl, what you doing?"
Yeah, it's Labor Day weekend. I was just wondering if you had plans.
Are you barbecuing? Are you going to U.S. Open?
Right, by chance.
Don't even try it. Yeah. So. But yes, we used to go all the time.
Nice. All right. So, okay, that's a start. We got a lot to talk about. I know in your high school years, some great things were happening too, even with the singing. So we can get to that in a minute. But let's see where CJ Flash starts us out with his musical journey. You ready to hear some of your stuff?
I guess. It's been so long. I'm teasing. Actually, we've actually been gigging together. Let me touch. We've been since 2019, we went to France.
Okay.
We had no idea that there was this market that loved us there. So we reunited and we actually did a show, two shows in France and in Lyon, France.
So beautiful.
It was amazing. Nice. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. All right, I just got a note from Russell. Comcast has an outage in his area. He's going to be back as soon as he can. So we're going to try to.
Yeah, I think Mercury's in Gatorade today. I got some internet issues also. So we'll see.
Well, we're all good. We're all here. So, CJ, what do you got to get us started? Go ahead, bro. That's funky. Who is that? And who's that on the bass?
Right.
Huge then. Dance music was huge.
Uh-huh.
We were on the same label as D-Train and, you know, we were with like Sky and, you know, a lot of groups. So it was a great beginning for, you know, for me. And I really was so happy to be with, like, we were modeling ourselves after like Chic, the group Chic.
Mm-hmm.
It was two girls and four guys. And,
right.
You know, when you're new, sometimes coming out as a soloist is scary. So when you do the group thing, it's like college. You learn what to do, what not to do. You're watching other acts. So Unlimited Touch was like, it was college for me. So I spent only 1 year in college. I wanted to be singing. I got a scholarship and everything, but I was just like, I hate this.
Yeah.
My parents were like, do you know how hard it is for us to get a scholarship? I was like, I hate it.
Oh.
Yeah, I hated it. Because it was theater. It wasn't recording, it was theater.
Okay. Yeah.
I love theater, but that's not where my heart was.
Yeah, yeah.
Would you say that did WKTU really support Unlimited Touch? Or yeah, was our okay.
Yeah, they did. A lot of the DJs. They did actually. I mean BLS as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, uh-oh.
Oh, you're on mute.
Okay.
I can't hear you.
What, me?
No, Miss Audrey.
Oh, okay.
Your sound went out.
Yeah.
You know what tends to happen if you're in earbuds? Yeah, if you're in earbuds, then if they died, then it may stop. See, I told you all, Mercury is in retrograde. Yeah. In Gatorade.
Yeah.
Gatorade. Big old vat of Gatorade today.
Okay, Archer, we can't hear you. So if you have no earbuds?
Uh-oh. Kill them.
Yeah, just take them and throw them on the other side of the room. Turn your.
It's a pro. You got to know EJ or D minor. Who's playing bass on that while Audrey's working it out?
I'll find out.
Yeah. Okay.
I'll tell you momentarily.
Yeah. All right, while we're doing that, let me run our commercial from our sponsor this week. Y'all ready for this?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Berkeley, get ready for the legendary Incognito, now featuring Mesa. Sunday, April 7th at Freight and Salvage in downtown Berkeley. Two shows at 6 and 8:30. Incognito with Mesa. With special guest Annie Chantel. Get tickets at thefreight.org. And coolrhythmandgrooves.com. Incognito and Mesa live.
That I like that. I'm gonna be at that show. We got you now. We got you now.
They got me. Welcome back.
Sorry, I was looking around like, ooh.
It's not you. It's not you.
Oh, it's the what you were talking about. Oh,
Mercury is in Gatorade. Okay. Say it one more time.
Okay. All right. So we're good to go. So yeah, who was playing bass on that one? Do you remember?
A guy named Sandy Anderson. He was the founder. Him and Lenny Underwood. They formed the group, mm-hmm. and they wrote most of the songs. And Brown Heights Affair produced it.
Oh, look at that.
All the way to the left. And so funny that you would ask about him. We actually lost him during
our condolences.
He was one of the first people in Jersey to pass from it because he was a kidney transplant
patient. Jesus.
He had a compromised immune system. And before we really knew
what was going on,
we kept talking to him. We said, Sandy, you know, you're helped. You got to really be careful. And he was like, I don't believe this. And his girlfriend, she apparently had it first.
Oh my God.
He brought it into the house.
My God.
Oh my God. It was just so now when we do shows, we had to find another bass player, but we never forget him because he was such an integral part
of course. Like,
he was just an amazing bass player and a great guy.
He's like a lead singer on that track.
Absolutely.
You know?
Mm-hmm. He was. He did a lot of the vocals and we miss him live. Like we're so used to him. Adding sometimes he would sing the higher notes than me and Stephanie's. We miss him dearly.
Wow.
I was just talking to Lenny today. So that they grew up together in the Bronx. So they formed the group first and wrote a lot of the material. And
rest in peace.
Blessings to him. Blessings to
him. Well, you mentioned Crown Heights Affair, and you know, I'd be remiss if we didn't mention the Reed brothers, and they were such an intricate part of Crown Heights Affair, and then obviously coming in and working with you guys and building that up. And how was Crown Heights Affair? What were they like as far as working with them?
They taught me so much. Ray Reed and William Anderson, you know, mm-hmm. William, we call him Bubba. He's still alive. But Ray Reed and his brother Bert Reed, I have to say that with Bert is the bald. No, I don't know where he is in this picture.
No, he's not in this picture.
He's not in this one.
But his brother is. One with
Mookie,
the gap.
I see Mookie. I see Ajax. We lost him too.
Yeah.
Phil is still alive. Skip and I are very close. But with Bert would use me to do the demos for a lot of songs that are on the radio. I did all of the French Jolie stuff. She pretty much copied. He would tell me what to, you sing it, and she would copy it.
Wow.
Empress, Dying to Be Dancing.
Wow.
Do it to the music. That's me. I did all those. You know, even though it was Delroy Morgan, Denroy Morgan, they learned the song from the demo that I would do. So they would say, Archie, come in and sing this demo. I want you. So Bert was like really into rhythms and, you know, they taught me mic techniques and, you know, well, those are the days when you used to really clap to do, you know, like claps. We'd have we'd be like, okay, I'm out. And they're like, no, y'all gotta do claps. Like, and we in there trying to clap, you know. So
that's why they hit so hard, though. That's why they hit better.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
No worries.
You know, so we learned how to blend, you know, doing it over and over again. It was just like that was my, I came straight from my high school. I never really was in a recording studio. So, you know, I was very eager to do whatever they told me to do. So it was cool for me. But the Reed brothers were, people don't know about them. Like even Funky Sensation. That's me and Stephanie. It was a big hit. But the backgrounds are me and Stephanie, the girls from Unlimited Touch.
Wow.
And that's kind of how I started getting the name. All the producers would be, who's those girls singing on Funky Sensation?
Yeah.
And then all the DJs, like, you know, John Roby and Jelly Bean, we started getting calls from people that I didn't know who they were, but it was like, you paying me? Okay, yeah. What do you need me to say?
Pulling up.
You know, you want that same? You want Funky Sensation sound? Okay, we
can do
that. Right.
You know, it just kind of snowballed from there.
Nice. Okay.
So, well, we told you he was the Encyclopedia Britannica. He knows about the Reed Brothers.
See.
Eh?
He's scared.
Right out the box.
Yeah.
Knowing about Sandy. Are you from New York?
No, I'm not from New York, I love WKTU and WBLS, so that BK Kirkland, Frankie Crocker,
right?
That whole synergy and, like, you know, that whole East Coast vibe, that New York vibe, I should say, is just amazing.
Yeah,
he scares us too. He's only 16 years old.
He's only 12, right? That's what I say.
Right.
And Frankie Crocker was a big supporter of rock group. Loved rock.
Okay.
And, you know, he was the man in New York.
Oh, so, yeah, he sure was.
At that point, you know, he put us on a lot of shows, and then we were on Prelude with, like, you know, D-Train. So we were, a lot of times we did a lot of shows together. So it was like a little family, just traveling. So
nice.
Boring, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah, there we go.
All right, now, while you were in high school, something else big happened to you. CJ Flash, give us a little hint.
Does he know? He knows.
Yeah,
he knows.
Hello, Daddy.
Hello, baby. How's my love child?
Fine.
Tell me, of all your dreams, what most do you hope to be when you become a big girl?
Daddy, I would like to be Miss Black America.
I haven't heard that.
Stepping so proud. Mother Nature's only godchild. Society salutes you today. And we'd like to say, God bless this Black America.
Audrey Wheeler
was
a high school senior. You were a contestant. I was going to say applied for, but you were a contestant in the Miss Black America New York pageant.
Absolutely.
And this is the first on the show that we've done. We haven't had any Black America pageant contestants. Have we had any?
Yes,
I don't think so.
Okay, you got the wait. Zoom in on that.
We
got
to get close.
That's
on that.
Classic.
This is the real. There you go.
Yes. That was school for me too, because it actually prepared me for, you know, the industry. I mean, like, in a way, I had never had anyone do my makeup and, you know, provide clothes for us. And there was a choreographer named Frank Hatchett. I don't know if you guys would know who he is, but
yeah,
he did a lot of Broadway stuff. And he was the choreographer. So he knows, it's funny. And so, you know, I never really took dance class, but, you know, we had to learn this choreography. I have some of the people that were in the pageants with me are lifelong friends. You know,
I watched
them in the industry. Some of them have been on TV shows, actresses. You know, one of my closest friends is a girl named Sharon Johnson. She's my daughter's, you know, godmother. So it was the beginning. They were older than me. I was the youngest one in the pageant, but watching these women and just had the poise and, you know, whatever, I mean, cause you have to wear a bathing suit. You have to, it's just like, wow, I have to do what? Walk in front of these people. You know, I'm 17. I'm just like, ooh. But it was because I had done plays and all the theater stuff in my school. And another young lady said, you know, you should try out, you know, I'm going to be doing it. She was a dancer. And she told me about it. My parents were surprisingly like, at that point, I had been doing plays and stuff since the 10th grade. So now they were just like, oh my God, they couldn't stop. My daughter sings. You want to hear her sing? It's like, no.
that was Al Jackson involved?
Actually, he wasn't until the end.
Okay,
this
till
was
the
like
end.
A local, and it's funny, one of the women who was in the pageant with me, she ended up managing this group, Sweet Sensation, which I did the demos for them too, but her name is Sherry Shepherd, but she was a contestant. And then she went on and she started running the pageant too. So it's like you do the local before you get to the That's why I said, you know, there will be Miss Black America Detroit or, you know, different Michigan, maybe, you know. So this was the New York, and then you go on to the
all I'm picturing is Coming to America.
And look, what's funny is that's Queens.
That is Queens.
The movie is, I'm gonna tell you, it's that's Forest Hills, where the house where Eddie lived.
Yeah,
that's an area that, you know, where, you know, like, you know, I guess middle class and upper class Black people lived. It was a big deal to live in. So when we see the houses, we're all like, we know exactly what those houses are.
That's so funny.
They were very authentic, and even the McDowell's with that. That's on Queens Boulevard. They turned a McDonald's into a McDowell's.
Yeah.
So that's where I grew up for real. That's really like my.
Well, you should have had a part in that movie.
You should have. They should have studied from you.
That's amazing. I wish I would have. I wish I had.
But, you
know, I've known the LL Cool J's and the, you know, the Queens people. I worked with him. I mean, I did all that. Fat Boys. That was my first. Well, not my first, but, you know, I did all of the
Oh, CJ.
I'm sorry.
Okay, okay.
It's all right.
You are your life. Yeah, this is your life, Audrey.
This is your life, Audrey.
He's scary.
Hey, but like I was saying, you were the first runner-up and you got a scholarship out of it. So I want to know how Dad went from not wanting you to sing with no boys at 14 to putting you up there in a swimsuit at 17. Yeah. Dad had an awakening, didn't he?
He was there just as proud. And it's funny because that's how I met Crown Heights.
Crown Heights.
They were the judges.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And after it was over, this woman who was like, they say she was a ringer, but she had gone around. She had been in other pageants. She was older than all of us, very, very sophisticated. Mm. But really, we didn't see her like throughout the choreography. She seemed to just like pop in and was like, wait a minute, was this set up that she was going to win? And so after it was over, I'm taking pictures with my family, and Crown Heights comes over to my dad and mom, and they're like, excuse me. And they said, I just want to say to you, you got robbed. You should have won.
Oh, wow.
Right.
And I was like, oh, that just made my day, though I didn't, you know. And I was just, he said, you know, we wanted you to win. You know, you had our vote. And they gave my father the number, and then they came to my father to the house.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
We had this group, and it's Unlimited Touch, and I promise you we'll take care of her. We'll watch her like a hawk, and, you know, we'll be like uncles to her. And, you know, they had to convince my dad because he was just very, very strict.
You know, he was like,
nope.
Like, all right.
One of five with my five girls. And, you know, they honored it. You know, they came near and told my dad, you know, we would watch out. Because, you know, my mom was very, oh, you're going to move to L.A. and you're going to do drugs. And, you know,
so, oh, no.
Time out, mom.
Slow down.
What are we doing here?
We're doing that now.
Right.
So they had one guy that said, you know, I would have her back. And he did. He would, whenever he would see anything, you know, because I was naive. So it would be like guys would be trying to talk to me or whatever. And they'd be like, nope.
Mm-mm. Not that one.
Which one was that?
Sister, Skip. Skip.
Oh.
We call him Skip, but he's a lead singer. Him and Phil were the,
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Skip Boardley.
Skip Boardley,
right in the front, right in the front. Yeah, to this day, we're still very close.
Nice.
Wow, Skip, attaboy, Skip, attaboy.
My dad loved him for that. He was like, I love you. You said you were going to watch my daughter, and you did.
Mm-hmm. That's beautiful.
Yeah.
That's good. So that must have been a great experience. So do you have any of the memorabilia? You have a sash or a crown or something?
I actually do, but it's at my parents' house, actually, really? In their garage. Mm-hmm. You know, my dad kept everything.
Her dad is still wearing when he's cutting the grass out front.
My baby got robbed.
My dad is in heaven. But you know,
God bless him.
That's right. And my mom. But, you know, he was extremely quiet. My dad was a United Sky Cat.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
So over the years, I would, like, let's just say I would do a session and I would sing with B.B. Winans or something. And, you know, it would be a session for, you know, Vanessa Bell Armstrong, and B.B. came in the door. And I remember Vanessa was like, oh, this girl, she's hanging with us because with Vanessa, it's her sisters that sings backgrounds for her. So one of her sisters wasn't there, so I took the place. And, you know, nervous, I'm like, I'm singing with Vanessa Bell Armstrong. BB walks in, and they were like, BB, don't she look like, they thought I looked like someone who was married to his sister. I forgot the Winans, but she's in the gospel.
Marvin.
Yeah, Marvin's wife.
Marvin's
Vicky.
Wife.
Vicky Winans.
They kept saying, she don't look like Vicky. He said,
yeah, no. I can see that.
I guess, yeah, sure.
and then when they said my name to him, he was like, I've heard of you. I know your name.
Yeah.
He said, you know something? I think I met, does your father work for United? I was
like, oh, wow. No.
Why? Because this man came, he said, do you know my daughter? happened. Jennifer Holliday.
Oh, my goodness.
I was so embarrassed, Daddy. And people were like, he's so proud of you. Don't get. My mother was like, he's so proud of you, but I would end up working with these people. But he would tell them about it. You know, like Glenn Jones would be like,
yeah,
it's your dad telling you, you need to call my daughter, have her sing on
you. He was like, that's great.
Yeah, no, for real.
Yeah, your reputation.
It used to embarrass me, but like, you know, now it's like, oh my God.
That's so precious.
He's proud, you know?
Yeah, that's precious.
Being that you were in that Crown Heights Affair camp and by way of D-Light Records, and was there ever any interplay with Kool and the Gang, and being that those two entities were there?
No. I just remember maybe doing some shows with them, but no.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Are you watching IRT? I'm sorry, go ahead.
The Strikers.
Yeah, the Strikers. Yeah.
The group that did Gloria.
Oh, Enchantment.
Enchantment.
Oh, you were on that one too?
No, I think that's not that song, but
label
they produced. Yeah. And I did backgrounds on a couple of songs. So whatever they were doing, you know, me and Stephanie would become, you know, that's how I ended up on records. And
the
beautiful thing is producers talk to other producers. So
that's right.
Who'd you use on that? So
yeah.
I told people, like, we have a daughter that is, she's in theater, and, you know, I said, you got to crawl before you walk. It may seem like you're at this age and you're not getting where you want, but you never know who's watching. You never know that person that you think is, oh, they're not important, and they could place you in something that never know. So I mean, I tell her, don't go there with the expectation, you know, just always be prepared.
So, you and Will aren't out there telling him, hey, you guys hurt my daughter?
No. Right.
You're not doing that for
her? You would have to know him. Well, you probably do know him. That would be enough. What he does is more like, if you're going to represent the Downing name, you better don't play around. Don't play. She's a jokester, so sometimes she plays around. He's like, mm-mm, don't do that.
Don't do that.
She does it on purpose. She'll sing bad in the house, just so we go, uh-uh. Or she'll tell her friends, watch this. And then she'll sing like really hideous, like not good. And we try to ignore it, and then we find like, hey, what are you saying? That's not the right song. And then we forget she's just messing with us.
This she is trolling you.
Oh yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
All right. So what's her name? So we'll be on the lookout.
Lynn Downing.
Asia Lynn Downing. Writing that down.
She's on the East Coast.
She sure is. She's in Brooklyn.
Yeah. I'm a producer and a theater.
Wow. She did Dreamgirls in Phoenix.
Okay.
2 month run and stole the show. I'm biased because we're very critical.
There you go, Ryan.
I know. I'm like, I need a principal who can sing. So
we need to talk.
We do.
Mommy's gonna promote her baby girl, but yeah.
Do that. Yeah, do that.
Yeah, she wants to go. We're going to England in June. She's like, I want to go, Mommy. So she's been coming to sessions, and since she was in my stomach, she's been around it. Like, you know, Will had to tell her, you know, age. Not too many people call people Aunt Shaka and Auntie Patty.
Hello.
You know, he has to tell her because she's just like thinks it's. Well, she did when she was younger, like, you know, backstage and talking to Al Jarreau, and it's like, hey, this is,
this is different.
She went to hug Layla Hathaway. We're like, come over here.
She's like, that's my partner.
No, she was talking to my dad, right?
Mm-hmm. Right. It's not a problem.
Oh, yeah. So she definitely,
that's beautiful.
You know, yeah, she's been, you know, we've definitely tried to show her the pitfalls, because for her, sometimes in that way, we do that. But like, we used to come home from like, touring, and she would say, Mommy, you and Daddy are so lucky, you guys get to go around. You always come home and you guys fall asleep on the couch. Why? You should be so happy. And I said, okay. I took on the road with me with Shaka, and we had to, you know, she was up late at night, and then the next day lobby call was like 4 a.m. and she was like, I was like, come on, baby.
Yeah.
She went right upstairs to her room. I said, you tired?
Right.
You tired?
You should be excited.
Yeah. Right. You should be excited. You just went. She's like, okay, Mommy, I get it. It's like the traveling is the rough part. You know, what we're on stage is what we love to do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we had to
all in between.
It's a show business.
That old thing about show business being 95% business, 5% show.
Right. You know? Right.
And in case somebody out there has not put two and two together yet, your husband is Will Downing.
Yes.
And Oprah Winfrey is your guys' auntie. There you go. So.
Right.
I'm like, that's Oprah.
We're wearing matching sweaters. Yeah, we're not.
Lovely. I have so many questions about your household. I'm sure you all are singing all the time. I can imagine. I mean, I can just imagine being there.
Can I just tell you what is the funniest thing? That is the thing that everyone says. And if you guys only knew, and he's in another room, he can hear me too. What we sing is commercials. We don't sing, you know, everybody thinks we're like, pass the butter.
There you go.
We sing commercials. We like, you know, we hear commercials that, and we're harmonizing. We don't plan it, but he might be in one room and I'm in another.
That's hilarious.
Commercials, we're like, they're catchy.
Yeah.
And, you know, and then if she's home now, three of us are singing together. So
I love
it. It's more of a informal thing. It's not
you
like,
sing that Pepto-Bismol one, the upset song, diarrhea. Diarrhea.
They made that sound so good.
Diarrhea.
They do make it sound good.
No, what's the other one that AG went with?
AG Wentworth.
Actually, we do sing that one.
I know you got to sing that Cards for Kids because that's in everybody's head. 1-877 Cards for Kids. Kids.
Yeah. Y'all better stop. That's going to be in all of our heads at 3 in the morning.
You're all going to get off humming it. But that's
right.
No, I do. I do.
We don't sing together. We do. Obviously, we have a studio at home, so you know, I'll come down and sing on his records and stuff.
Well, yeah, amazing. you do it for money, but you're not doing it for free. You know,
no, money. No, I'm just playing. No, I'm, you know, I'm watching this. Can you come down and sing this part? Sure.
Yeah. But, amazing.
You know, the commercial thing is hilarious, and sometimes in the car when we're driving in the car, we might, you know, that's how we actually heard that. I knew that our daughter could sing because we were listening to Erykah Badu. And it was the Call Tyrone songs on it. Mm-hmm. And she was like, "You like that?" She was a little girl. "You like that?" Yeah, I don't like it. We were like, "Asia, it's a big song." And she was like, "You better call." She started saying, we were like,
"Six." Do that one more time.
It was out. And you know, we would listen to her singing in her room. And, you know, that was before she knew. You know, she liked what she liked. She liked, I like Britney Spears. We were like, Okay. Broaden your horizons, you know. Let me introduce you to Brandy Norwood.
There you go.
That's what I did. And then she was like the posters of her. So
amazing.
We are a musical family, I will say.
Bet. Oh, I can't to be a fly on the wall.
Now you brought up commercials. I have to look at your here. It said you did a lot of jingle work with Burger King, Jenny Craig, Just for Men Hair Care, and Popeyes. Did you do that Popeyes one?
But this is an old. You know, you got to remember they do different campaigns.
Yeah,
long. So I don't even remember. This was like in the 90s.
So you didn't do that Love That Chicken from Popeyes. You didn't
do that? we did sing that.
Okay. Oh,
we did.
That's
right. Jenny Craig thing was a like for people that were members of Jenny Craig, they would get these tapes.
Yeah.
It was actually not singing. It was actually like I was an Oprah Winfrey character. Oh, and funny. When I got in the room, it was like all these people from like One Life to Live. And I was like, oh, that's the girl from One. You know, I was trying to be professional, but I was like freaking out. Like, that's Jared from, you know,
from Subway.
They were acting.
Not Jared from Subway. Not Jared from Subway. Don't say that.
Way
on the air again.
Yeah.
Not that Jared. No.
Okay, good deal.
Jared's on the lam right now with
We know where Jared is.
They're both in Grenada somewhere.
Right. How's the difference in doing jangles to basically working in the studio and
not
working.
Jangles, D minor.
I like
Jangles.
Not
Jangles.
Jangles Unchained. My man said Jangles.
Black jingles for all the rest of it.
I was gonna let it go, D, but two of the bottom row got you, man.
Jingles.
Explain yourself. Explain
how
yourself.
How it is doing Jangles.
The funny thing about it is there's clients there. So if you're doing something for AT&T or they're there, they're like in behind the glass, they're in the control room and you're in there. And it's a lot more stiff. I shouldn't say stiff, but it's more, unless they want the R&B, they'll do like a pop version, a country version, and then you'll do an R&B version. But it's still really, they know what they want. You might sing something that's really great and they're like, oh, when you did that little thing right there, the words that we need to emphasize, that little thing is taking away from it. So then let's just say this thing straight like they want. Because they're trying to sell their product. So it is different. It's different.
So
I've done a doll commercial and I had to sing like it's the commercial called Just For Me. I don't know if y'all know, but it's like,
Just For Me.
Absolutely. That is me. But you have to sing it like a little girl. So they were like, Can anybody sing like a little girl?
That was you.
It's acting. Mm-hmm. So it's
every time I used to go get a perm, I would sing your song.
That's one of those R&B products. That's
me too.
You too, huh, Russ? And look what happened to you.
Yeah,
I didn't get a free product, but it was
Just For Me and Kitty Kit. This is an episode of Just For Me and Kitty Kit, right here.
You're watching IRTS Live. Our guest is Audrey Wheeler Downing. We got the whole crew with us: CJ Flash, Big Russ, Ryan Nicole, D Minor. I am Jerry G Dove, and we got some more music from Miss Audrey coming like right now. Go ahead, Flash.
So I have to give you guys a correction on that song.
Okay.
That is Melissa Morgan singing that song.
What?
However,
okay,
she was temporarily for a very short period of time, she was in Unlimited Touch.
Wow.
Okay.
So it's so funny that you guys full circle, but one of the young ladies who started the group, Stephanie, decided she didn't want to be in the industry anymore. Mm-hmm. So we held auditions. And Melissa, we did gigs together as Unlimited Touch. Mm-hmm. And then when I Hear Music blew up, the other girl was like, I want to come back because I didn't know it was going to be a hit. And so, yeah, so it's funny that she would play that. That's because I know Melissa would be like, that's my song.
That's so funny.
We actually had her on one night.
I know, she was great. So we know each other. We're from Queens.
Yeah.
Both of us are from Queens. Mm-hmm. But she's singing on Private Party, the one you first played. That's me and Melissa singing on that.
Mm-hmm. So, oh, wow.
Yeah. But, you know, her time in the group was not as long.
Right, well, that's all right. Flash got one to two on right now. He got one of your own. Go ahead. Go ahead, Flash.
CJ rarely gets stumped.
Go ahead, Flash. Give him one to two. I don't know. Do you ever listen to Sirius XM?
Oh, yeah.
They played the hell out that song.
Sirius XM. On the funky station, right?
Yes.
Yeah, on the groove.
On the groove. On the groove.
And it's funny. Isn't what's his name? Fred Bugsy?
Fred Bugsy. Jeff.
Bugsy is another one that played our records a lot.
Yeah.
We actually lived in the same building before I moved. We lived in the same building.
Yeah. BK Kirkland was holding down the group for a long while.
And he's another one from New York, right?
Yeah, WBLS.
Yep.
You know, for every million plays that they do on that XM, you're going to get about 12, 13 cents. You know that.
Yeah. 12 cents.
Watch out, balling.
I knew you were going to say. Actually, isn't it the people who wrote the song? Because that would be
Lenny. That's
I don't even
worse,
think I'm getting 12 cents. I don't It's all good. It's okay.
It's a fraction of 12 cents.
This industry, I am blessed, so I'm not even going to trip on that.
Well, that's why we're here, to remind people that you did that kind of work. So they're going to go see you.
She did.
Right. They'll see you in an area. So that's why we're here.
Right there.
Right there. That's right.
Okay, so you are a highly sought out background singer, as it sounds. You know, you've worked with Madonna, Gwen McCrae, Jellybean Benitez. You mentioned earlier Fat Boys and Curtis Blow. That whole bottom row plus CJ are all hip hop fanatics. So I know they want to hear some good stories about the Fat Boys and Curtis Blow. So,
well, I'd say Curtis Blow.
Don't get it twisted. Jerry is a hip hop fan too.
Oh,
he just doesn't know it.
Yeah.
And LL Cool J too. LL Cool J was the chillest one of all of them. So that was Russell Simmons' label. Me and a girl named Allison Williams, we did Fat Boy. Wow. We did basketball. We did games people play.
I mean, yeah.
We did all of them. We were the girls, the background girls for that. So, So, yeah, I've known them since they were, you know, I was just glad to be on. And Russell when Russell sees me with Shaka, he's always like, oh my God, you're still singing. Oh, I'm so glad. I'm so proud of you.
Yeah.
And I got him back to see Shaka one time. It was a private event at the guy Perlman who owned Revlon. Mm-hmm. He had a private party and had Shaka as his entertainment. And mm-hmm. when I looked in the audience, I saw all these famous people, and I saw Russell. And he looked over, and he was like, Audrey, I want to say hi to Shaka. So I brought him back, you know.
Nice.
And he was just that's like, tough. Oh, my God, I can't believe you're still doing it. I'm like, yep,
yeah.
yeah, this is yeah. what I need to do.
But that's
yeah.
right.
Yeah, so is those it things were it was a new genre. And if I'm honest with you, if you were not used to doing hip-hop, and I'm going to be honest with you, it was a little scary. Because it was this new genre, and you know they were street, you know, and you're in there waiting to do a session, and they come in, you know, and the fat boys were just like you saw them. They were hilarious, like you know,
yeah.
Always making sounds and always eating. They ate all.
Oh man,
just eating,
just on brand.
Oh yeah, yeah. But LL was the quietest one. When I see him on TV now, I'm just like. He was the mellow one. He really
wow.
did. Until he got on the microphone, he was.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
So, what song did you do with L? I mean, like, at what?
I can't even remember.
At the very beginning, or just?
In the very beginning. So, it would okay. be.
So, his first also, album.
Yeah, the first album. If you look on the credits, I'm all on it. And then also, what's this guy? Oh, God. Y'all know. I wrote a song about it. What's his name? He. Oh, my God.
David Alan Greer.
No,
wrote a song about it? Like here.
No, I followed you home from. I followed you home from.
Oh, Orange Juice Jones. Oh my God!
Yeah, we used to do jingles. Wait,
CJ, what's happening over there?
Yeah. He's falling apart.
Yeah.
To this day, hold on. He found me on social media, and he was just like, "Oh, Audrey," and I was like, "Lauren." Yeah,
that's crazy.
Yeah, and one of the producers that I work with jingles. They brought him in to do a jingle, and you know, I sang background, so it was like full circle when it came to that. But during those days, and dance music was just starting to grow, so it was like rap at first, or hip hop, and then dance music, you know. Mm-hmm. And you know, you didn't care what kind of music someone hired you for; you just did it, you know.
Yeah.
But that shows you it makes you well rounded. So if you ever get hired by anyone, you feel like you can do it all, you know. It's like mm-hmm. school.
Well, it just goes to show that dance music obviously has such a presence in New York, really? Being that Fat Boys was Disco 3 at first, and so their sound was kind of in that vein of disco hip hop,
or
reality music, if you will.
Dance, I think dance music is really big in New York and Chicago. Chicago is like, oh my God, it's still
Detroit too.
Detroit too. Okay, I know Chicago. But yeah,
and we talked to a lot of folks from New York, and it just seems like as big as that area is, it just seems like this small network because you all know each other. And everybody that you're saying, you are not dropping names because I can tell already you're not the kind of person, but everybody that you work with way back then is somebody we know now.
Right. Yeah.
So did you guys know how cool it was when this was all happening, or were you just working?
The funny thing is, it's pockets. It's like you said, my husband is from Brooklyn. So, you know, he grew up with Barry Eastman, who turned out to be this huge producer. You know, then even Unlimited Touch, some of the guys, they're from Detroit, they're from the Bronx. I was from Queens. I grew up with the Najees, you know, like the Basement Bands.
Yeah.
Trying to get, and then the trumpet player, you know, I mean, I grew up looking, it was more jazz for me and R&B bands. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, we end up knowing each other later on, but in the beginning, it's kind of based on your borough, where you live. And then a lot of them went to the performing arts school. And then that's where everybody like, well, where are you from? And then you start hiring different people and different sounds. But it's so many boroughs. It's like, it's the Bronx, Brooklyn, Queens, Staten Island, Long Island. So it's like when you start thinking about all the famous musicians and stuff, it's a big place. But then when you get older and you start working, it's very small. You know somebody who knows somebody who knows somebody. It's like that. Because it's a lot of recommendations. Like, I need a girl to do this, or I need someone to do that. Then they start thinking outside their area.
Like, yeah.
This cat in the Bronx who is a good rapper. So that's how it kind of, you know. And that was the days of bands. Everybody
that's great.
Had
bands. Yeah. That's great.
And, you know, in Queens, we had basements. So it was like the basement bands.
Yeah. Okay.
That was a thing. Yeah.
That's so cool.
James Brown lives where, like, not far from where I live. James Brown was there. It was a lot of jazz cats.
Wow.
James Brown.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I heard he had a mansion in Queens.
Yeah, he did have a mansion. And, you know, it's funny. Where he lived is where Nashi had a house there. Hubert Eaves Sr. lives there now.
Yeah.
So it's still a thriving area. And, you know, in the LL Cool J, I don't know if anybody remembers in some of the videos, it was like a big red, black, and green rock.
Yeah.
He did a video. That's literally like 7 minutes from my home, my family home.
Wow. Oh, wow.
These are real areas, you know.
Yeah.
When you see it, it's just like, oh, I grew up.
That's home. Yeah. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
That's so dope.
Yep.
Yeah. It's pretty cool. It is. All right. Keep it going, Flash.
That's it. We found it.
Hey, hey, baby, how you doing? Come on in here. Got some hot chocolate in the stove waiting for you. Listen, first things first, let me hang up that coat. Yeah, how's your day today? Did you miss me? Oh, you did. Yeah, I missed you too. I missed you so much, I followed you today. That's right. Now close your mouth, because you're cold busted.
They're playing basketball. We love that basketball. Ball. They're playing basketball. We love that basketball. They're playing basketball. We love that basketball. They're playing bad boys.
Oh my gosh.
Bad boys.
Oh my gosh.
DJ Flash. Very good. Hey, DJ Flash.
We actually do that in our show. When we do our Unlimited Touch shows, we do all the songs that we, you know, our band members have also played on a lot of songs as well. So, you know, half the band Unlimited Touch is playing, our keyboard player, guitar player, everybody's on it. So it's like, as part of the show, because we've all worked with so many people, we make that a part of the show.
Yeah.
That's cool. Everybody's
always like freaked out, like, oh my God, I didn't know y'all sang on that.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's so cool.
Now, let me ask you this. So we ask this a lot of lead singers and group members and things like that, but as a background singer who works with so many people, and you don't have to say any names unless you want to, you know when a song's a hit and we're like, okay, I'm singing background, but ain't nobody gonna hear this, you know? So you just like, sometimes you just say no, just say no, man. I'm just gonna do my job and get out of here.
Right, in the studio. But you know what? There are some exceptions as well. Like, you know, the famous Tina Turner hated What's Love Got to Do With It? She hated it. And so sometimes you don't know. And there are absolutely songs that my current boss, Mishaka Khan, hates that are huge hits that you all love.
Yes. She does not tell a secret about that. She makes that clear.
I read it in her book. Yeah. I read that she will never sing Sweet Thing again. She just does this for her. You guys do, but she lets all of us sing it.
Well, she actually lets one of our other background singers. Yeah. She lets her do the solo, and she's not really a fan of Through the Fire, but we think it's a memory. Something must have been going on during the time of the song. So sometimes... Okay. She'll say, we'll say, what about this? And she'll say, we'll see. And we know that there's something about it, you know.
Yeah.
And also, she hates that when people see her in the airport, everybody says,
"No, don't do that."
Don't do that. You be a little more inventive. Can you?
Just, right.
So, you'd be surprised. You do. There are songs that you record that you obviously say, "This ain't gonna be." You just girl, just shut up. So, and then there's some that you say that and it ends up being a hit. Like,
yeah,
what?
Wow.
How did that happen?
You'd be surprised. Yeah. So,
do you grow to love it at that point, or is it just like,
yeah, little piece. That's me.
Right.
I say that.
Did you do more work with Gwen McCrae? Like Keep the Fire Burning. Did you do any of those songs?
So a guy named I can't remember his name. That was a time when Crown Heights and another guy, I can't think of his, a dance producer produced her. And I have to tell you a story about that song. They claimed that they wrote the song as far as the music goes, Funky Sensation. Mm-hmm. And she came in and made all them lyrics up. I'm calling all you. That was not written. That woman came in. Started singing, and it was a one take type of thing.
Wow.
They hadn't even written a song, and they said, "Well, let go in there and warm up. Let's see what you come out." And she just started singing.
Wow. They were like, press record.
Yeah. She's so amazing anyway. But
keeping that.
So,
very cool.
Hey, you're watching IRTS Live. It's Tuesday, so that means we are on. We've got Audrey Wheeler Downing with us. We got the almighty DJ CJ Flash, D Minor, this Encyclopedia Brown-Tanica. Ryan Nicole is an actress and artist and all these different things. Big Russ is just knows all the music, and I'm just here just trying to hold it all together. And I say that, Audrey, because last week we had Jesse Johnson on. You ever met that brother?
I've met him on the road, not really like knowing.
Okay, Jesse was great. First of all, let me say that we loved him, but we turned this on and all we could do was
let him go.
It was great. So
he's a storyteller. That's what that is. Oh
man, he tells some great stories. Absolutely, some great stories. I loved every minute of it. Yeah, I loved all 2 hours of it. Is what we're saying.
Oh,
you know. Wow.
So yeah.
So it was great story. So we appreciate. A little more interaction this week. It's a little bit of a terrible
week.
So if you guys are seeing the show for the first time, make sure you catch us every Tuesday at 7:00. If you're missing any of this show from the beginning, when we're done, about 5 minutes after that, click right back where you're watching now. It'll start all over again. DJ CJ Flash, we got some more music.
Always.
Jennifer says, Audrey's our queen from Queens.
Thank you, Jennifer.
Searching to find the one.
Mm-hmm. Roller
skating. That was a roll. That was our step. Mm-hmm. That's what we used to do. That was a big roller skating song.
Too. Yeah. You learned to be a good dancer? You learned to be a background dancer?
I'm okay. I'm okay. I can do the Shaka Khan dance really good. I'm not a choreographed, but yeah, I think
you could two-step, right?
Yeah, I could step a little bit two-step. No,
I know you can.
What's your daughter say? When she watches you guys, you dance, what she say?
She don't say nothing bad. I'm so proud of you, mommy.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
There you go.
She don't crack on me on that. Mm-mm.
Okay.
It's when I try to know about like social media, she's like, mm-mm, mom.
That's not true.
Don't say that, mommy. That's not what you said. Thank you, Kim.
That's funny.
Yeah, look me on the Book of Faces.
Right.
There you go.
Miss Audrey, I have a question for you.
Yes.
You mentioned that you were around Najee. You sang on his projects, and
did you happen to sing?
We're talking about roller skating songs now. Did you happen to sing on "Bet You Don't Know What's Going On"?
Mm. No, I think a friend of mine named Cindy Mizell sang on that.
Okay, Cindy Mizell.
Mm-hmm. I did it live. I toured with him for like 2 years, so I had to do it live.
That's a one.
It's a huge roller skating record out here.
Oh yeah. Oh, is it?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow.
A lot of folks skate to it's a little skaters out here. Yeah. Slower groove, but the older skaters are more into the slower groove, kind of jazzy feel kind of stuff.
Right.
Yeah.
I love how Usher's bringing
Yes.
I feel like they're bringing roller skating back. That was a thing to do.
Yeah.
I loved roller skating.
Yeah. I feel like the pandemic did that for a lot of people. Folks, it's certainly out here, like pandemic made people get out and figure out whatever the hell they were going to do with their bodies. Roller skating became one of them.
Man, you people were looking in mirrors going, who is that?
Right. It's an intruder in my house, right?
This is not me. Oh, it was out. And that's when you truly discovered if you were in a relationship, if y'all was meant to be together.
Yes. That's true.
It didn't take long for some
every
place,
day. It was like, you know, Groundhog Day. It was
seriously.
Out. I mean, the best thing for us was, you know, Will did a lot of performances. We had a green screen, and you know, we did some everyone was asking each other, "Would you sing on this for me?" And fortunately, we have a studio, so that was cool. You know, I was able to sing back my first couple of things.
Nice.
With the skating thing, I was pretty good. I had a problem stopping and turning, but other than that, I was pretty good on skates.
Well, you know what? It's such an important part of skating.
I'm so serious.
I'm skating and I can't stop.
Right.
Or turn. So I would from one wall, turn around and go back to the next wall.
There was no turns. And then the ones that hold on.
Yeah. That's me. Matter of fact,
last time we went skating, we went a bunch of friends. And they would send these little kids up. They give this kid $1 and he would just come just kind of hit me on the back of my knee.
Push you.
He didn't have to push me. He just made it look like he was going to hit me and I'm falling down.
Boop.
And they gave this kid $1 like five different times he came in.
Oh, my goodness. It became a thing.
I wasn't happy.
He had a job. Yeah, you weren't happy, Jerry?
I beat that little 8-year-old ass after. No.
Got him in the parking lot.
Don't do that.
I did not. I kid you. No, but that's the truth. They sent this kid just chasing after him. Go knock him down. And he just had to come close.
You're already doing this.
That cement is unforgiving, or that wood, or whatever it was. It felt like cement is unforgiving.
Oh my god!
Can you skate, Miss Audrey?
I can. I used to be able to roller skate. Ice skating, I never picked up.
Oh yeah, forget about ice.
Ice skating is hard.
Yeah, that's like sorry, couldn't do that.
I tried it. I didn't like. I also didn't like skiing. Oh my god, I tried that. That's
skiing. Skiing was cool, but ice skating. When I had two pieces of wood, I could ski. But
the old skates, but the one where you're balancing your feet. That's and don't lie about your weight because if you lie about your weight with the skates, you're gonna be like,
right?
You know, women, we always
I'm 120.
I'm only 1'5", 105.
Right, you know? Right.
And you're like 120, and then you get on the skates, and you're like.
Right.
Yeah, your weight plays a part in it. So I learned
good to know.
Yeah, this is not for me.
Not my bag.
Everybody says rollerblades are easier.
Yeah, they say rollerblades are easy because
they are, but
it's different.
Yeah, it is a little different. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Rollerblading used to be when you went to what's the beach in Los Angeles?
Venice.
That was the highlight of the whole rollerblading.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It was perfect for you, Jerry, because it was just a straight line. No,
that's true.
It was either Venice Beach or the Salt Flats in Utah. Those were your two spots.
Where's Jerry? They said he'll be back in about.
He'll be back. When he circumvents the globe,
all right. Come back around this way in the spring.
He comes back. He's got all these stickers on him: Brazil, Vietnam, London.
That's right. That's right. Notches on my belt from knocking out 8 year olds, you know. So I have
come Forrest Gump of skating.
All right, players. Let's get back. Let's get back to the music. But before we do that, okay, look. Now y'all said in the 80s. Okay, now we're gonna talk to the 80s. You worked with The System?
Yes.
Yeah, and Jeff Lorber on his hit Step by Step. Big time. And yes, were you on that song? You Are In My Sis. But that was you?
Yeah, I was on Don't Disturb His Groove.
Oh, heck yeah. That's the one.
Love that song.
Only me singing in the background.
What?
Yeah, okay.
Put that on.
All I do is just me and you.
That's right.
The joint.
Yeah.
That was the joint. That is a very overlooked slow jam.
Well, it's very funny.
Yeah.
Slow jam.
Don't Disturb His Groove?
Oh, yeah. They produced This Is My Night for Shaka.
Did they?
Oh,
absolutely.
Yeah,
so we do it. That's like one of our songs we do live. So I just saw him recently. They've gotten back together as well.
Oh, great.
And I was doing this show in Westbury. I don't know if y'all know. Westbury is way out in Long Island. And it was a reunion show, and it had Melba Moore, Lilo Thomas.
Oh, nice.
Lilo Thomas.
Here goes Lilo again.
I work with Lilo too.
I was just going to ask you. Okay. You got to ask. Okay. Please, Audrey.
Jumped out of his chair. Yeah,
okay, I got a question. Okay, who was first? Was it Lilo or was it Freddie? Who came first?
Lilo.
Okay, I just had I had a friendly argument with somebody.
Lilo. They were friends. They, you know, a lot of people don't know Freddie used to sing backgrounds. So me, Freddie, and Allison Williams, we used to sing backgrounds together. That's how I first met him. Hmm. And then all of a sudden, this record comes out, and he's huge. And, you know, it's another person that I've toured with for over 30-something years. And, you know, he's my friend. But, yeah, Lilo was first. I'm sorry. He was.
Okay.
That's just called the thing.
And they've co-written. Lilo has written stuff. He's a big writer, too.
Right.
He wrote a lot of stuff. So, yeah, Lilo. It was Lilo.
Okay. Yeah. Like you're a good girl and all of that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I'm about to do a show with him. I did one in Christmas time. And on the package was Howard. So Fine. So it was a great band.
Howard Johnson.
It was Howard Johnson, The System. And they didn't know I was going to be there singing with Lilo. Mm-hmm. And they called me out on stage and they said, she sang on This Is the Girl Who Sang the Hook. So I came out and they gave me a microphone. It was not prepared at all.
Oh, wow.
So,
mm-hmm.
These are all people that I love. And they were actually singing with The System. That's how I got Jeff Lorber Step by Step, because he had auditioned a bunch of singers in New York City, very well-known singers that you all know. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Jeff heard my voice and said, not like her.
Nice.
So I was just a background singer. It's like, you want to audition? I was like, okay. Mm-hmm. And that was my first really big tour, was with Jeff Lorber.
Nice.
You know, besides Freddie Jackson. Freddie Jackson was as a background singer. Mm-hmm. With Jeff, I was, you know, so I was a lead singer, and playing percussion. So it was growth, you know. It was
nice.
It was a step by step, as I tell my daughter. You know, it really is step by step.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Did I hear you say you were playing percussion?
I was playing percussions with Jeff, and I had never. They had a whole setup for me, and I was like,
nice.
Yeah, and that's a different world.
Playing triangle,
right?
I was with the shakers and the
We
need more cowbell.
Nice.
Okay, Sheila E. All right.
I was trying.
Flash, look, I got something queued up, so I know he's ready. He can't let that finger go, bro.
Hang the sign up on the door. I say, don't disturb this.
Yeah.
We were total strangers.
Oh my God.
And we both saw love, something close to danger. But now we know each other better. Things are moving onward and upward.
Audrey, you're pretty good, Audrey. You're pretty good.
That song was written by Anita Pointer. I don't know.
Oh,
West Coast, East Coast connection.
Anita Pointer. Yeah. Bet you had a chick on the side, Anita Pointer.
Yeah, I love. Okay. I grew up on them. Oh my god. Right. Yeah, Anita Pointer wrote that with Jeff Lorber, and she did the demo, and then she was like, "You did a great job." I was like, "Thank you."
Yeah. Well, you know, we're out here in the West Coast, and we're beautiful folks even live in Oakland, so we know all about the Pointer sisters out here.
Yeah.
So. Love
yeah.
Love we also, Najee also touched down here quite a bit.
Oh, yeah, yeah, no, I know.
Yeah. Yeah, you know.
He still has a home in Queens, but yes, he's.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Shout out to Lilo Thomas, the original unibrow. Yeah. Did, you sure.
Did you know that he almost made the Olympics?
What?
You know what?
He was a track star.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. The time that his record came out, he blew up. But he was in the trials for the Olympics.
Brown Tanica, I'm disappointed you didn't know that, Brown Tanica.
He'll know it. He got it now. Now he'll be like,
okay. I just knew the eyebrows.
Yes, you are correct. Unibrow, yes. All of his siblings have it. I mean, I shouldn't tell you. Oh, wow. No, seriously, yes. He has sisters. They have thick brows. Beautiful.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah.
You know, Johnny Mathis was an Olympic
sprinter. He sure was.
Yeah. What?
He sure was.
Oh, my mother loved him.
Wow. Yeah, everybody, my mother did too. He went to our church. He went to our church, and my mother was like, "Pickle Johnny."
I didn't know that. That was my mother. I don't care how tired she was. If he was coming on the Tonight Show or whatever, she's like, "I'm staying up for."
Gonna watch man, Johnny.
Oh, she loved him.
That is so funny.
And Champs she loved Lou Rawls.
Lou Rawls too.
Lou Rawls.
Both my parents love Lou Rawls. Yeah. You'll Never Find, that was their jam.
Start
dancing together.
That is so funny.
That was grown man soul music.
Sure
right
was.
Yeah.
Yes. Who knew?
Gotta have at least. I don't even know why they had buttons up here on their shirt. And then you gotta have a medallion.
The hair.
Yeah, gotta have a taco meat and the medallion right here.
Taco meat. Yeah.
And the collar of the shirt went way out to here.
Right. Yeah, that's definitely.
Couldn't wrong. Tell him nothing. Couldn't tell him nothing.
All right. Smell like Old Spice or Gray Flannel.
or
Gray Flannel was my dad.
Bruce, my Fabergé.
Gray Flannel was my dad.
Yeah. Oh,
my father was an Old Spice dude. He had the Old Spice. He had the whole kit. So it was easy to shop for him for Christmas. He had the whole kit.
You know, your grown man with Old Spice.
You know, with the shaving
that's
kit.
That's a commercial.
With the brush.
No, that's a commercial. Mm-hmm.
But you can't do that one because it's so hard to whistle and laugh at the same time.
I was
going to
say, I'm laughing, so I can't even do it.
Yeah,
were they trying to bring Old Spice back? Who's on there? Deion Cole. Deion Cole is trying to bring it back.
The commercials that's are hilarious.
True. That's true.
He's got me curious as to wondering what it smells like nowadays.
It's like Axe body spray for old people.
Well, you know, actually, the young boys get into it because they feel like it's sophisticated. Really? Yeah, I got a 10-year-old son, and
really?
If he has to choose between Axe and Old Spice, he feels like Old Spice is sophisticated.
Word,
wow,
yeah.
Somebody said Brute.
Yes, Brute. I'm on the list.
Avon,
High Karate, Irish Leather.
Irish Leather.
Who was the one that the yellow girl women? It was
Tracy. Gina Tay.
Gina Tay. That's it.
Mm. Yep. Avon. Gina Tay.
And the one with the commercial. I could bring home the bacon.
Oh, Ajali.
Yeah. Oh God.
Ajali.
Yeah. Oh geez.
That's so funny. Dang,
so when you woke up this morning, did you know you'd be talking about these kind of things?
No. But I will say that. You know, I do make jokes. Will and I make jokes like this.
I thought you were going to say Will has some high karate on right now.
he's the king of cologne. No, he's the king of cologne. Oh, my God.
Is he? Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Definitely.
High karate. That's hilarious. Look at CJ.
All right, Flash, a little bit more music, if you would, please.
Got you covered.
Wow. where did you find that?
If it takes a miracle, if it takes a thousand tries, I'm gonna get your love someday, something more than just one night. You're so deep inside of me, setting rhythms in my heart. When you hold me in your arms, I will.
All right, Flash, all right, you got some explaining to do.
Wow, where'd you find that?
Oh
my gosh.
I found that first album, that album that you did. This is the solo album, right?
Yeah.
The,
yeah. Oh my gosh.
This one?
Yep.
Nice.
Oh my gosh.
BJ never reveals his sources.
You two should let us in on that. What is that song?
Wow.
What you kept saying?
Oh, it was, what's that? Preston Glass, right?
Through the night.
Through the night.
Right. I mean, well, the producer was Preston
Glass. Yeah.
And it's funny, the title is Let It Be Me, and I didn't want to do that song. I didn't want to do it at all.
Yeah.
And,
no? Just like yourself.
No, but then if you see my daughter, everybody says it looks like my daughter, too.
Wow.
Yeah, I just was, you know, it's my first project. And for me, you have a vision of how you want it to go.
Mm-hmm.
And this industry can kind of slap you up a little bit and like teach you that you ain't controlling this like this.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I mean, you're not.
Yeah.
You can be, so many of my friends are great singers, but never got their due or never, because it's politics. It's not just about how talented you are, what you look like. You know, if a label doesn't push it, if the staff changes in the midst of doing the record, you know, and that's what happened to me, that the guy who signed me, all of them got fired, and then they don't re-sign you.
So, right.
You know, if you're smart, you go back and doing what you were doing, or you never stop doing it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So
if you're smart.
Also, like, you know, people that, I mean, like Lisa Fisher. I mean, Lisa Fisher got a Grammy, but was like, I got to pay my bills.
Mm-hmm.
Nice at a Grammy, but I'm going back on the road with the Rolling Stones because I'm making this kind of money.
Right.
So it's kind of like it's a different business than people. People have such a view of what they think it is. Like, you know, so many people think, oh, when you hear a record that you've sung on, they think we're getting paid. But we're not. Mm-hmm. Who's getting paid is the person who wrote the song. Maybe. Right. They're not getting their full worth. But
right.
So, perhaps. And
or it's
now
the person who owns the rights to the song.
Right. Yeah. It's the publisher, it's those people, the producers, the record company. But now there are some services, mostly in Europe, a few of them. One is called PPLUK. And what they've done is, PPL's phonographic. We've all like passed it on to each other. And any singers that are listening here, look it up. It's PPLUK.
Okay.
If you look it up, if you sung on any recording or anything of that nature, there may be residuals waiting for you. And a decent, not just like two pennies, because what it is that particular service in Europe, they pay you for if a jukebox is playing a song you sing.
Nice.
A roller skating rink, if a restaurant.
Wow.
America should be doing.
Yeah, America should be doing a lot of things.
Should have been doing this. So they actually really support, because they are, when you go to Europe, they love American music. So they're
absolutely.
And I say that we don't, but when I tell you the first time you go there and you perform, they are quiet as a mouse. These people are the same way. They don't, while the song's going on, they're like, so you're inside going, oh, they hate this. And you're like, huh? You're singing, and then like, and then when the song ends, they're like, they go,
wow,
much respect for the artist.
They want to hear every nuance that you're doing.
Yeah,
it's just a different, and not that there's anything wrong with people screaming out. I like that too, because America's that way.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, Africa's like that too.
Absolutely.
Africa's like that too.
That's right.
Thank you, Stephanie.
Thank you.
It's a different appreciation. So.
You know, a friend of the show, Davey D, he's a DJ and a journalist, a brilliant journalist, just put a post out about the RIAA that released a report that the streaming industry made $17.1 billion last year, and only 84% of that was made through streaming, and artists are getting a fraction I mean, it's less than a fraction.
It's so sad.
Yeah.
When you think about, when you look at some people who are, you looked at as, oh my God, they were such a talent in the 80s and 90s or whatever. And, you know, where are they now? They you know, like, you know, at least some of the people that do TV shows, you know, that are no longer doing major acting, they get residuals. They get something.
Right.
That should be fixed. It's got to be fixed. For so many years, people thought, oh my God, I heard you on the radio. Girl, I know you're getting paid. I said, getting paid what? What are you talking about? I get paid when I do a show. I'm not getting
paid. Right.
Well, that's one benefit, though, that these streaming services are also bringing some of this music back to the forefront. Yes. And it's allowing people like the system to get back together and go back on the road and make some real cash and get their flowers right now.
That's right. Mm-hmm. You're right about that.
So that is one benefit. But the people who control the publishing pirates from the 70s, 80s, and 90s, mm-hmm. they didn't have the foresight to know that this was going to happen. And they are caking right now.
Yes, they are.
They are making bread. Right now. There are so many people who could not spell microphone who are getting publishing rights right now.
And then sampling. I mean, we were so against it mm-hmm. at first, especially with mm-hmm. hip hop doing it. But then when like James Brown and other people made like, you're gonna give me my money for sampling. Like that's another thing we teach our daughters that, you know, she'll hear a song and we're like, especially Will, he's like, Asia, you know who did this song?
No, Dad. Like Chris Brown. Right.
just like the song that he played. They're playing bass. I mean, mm-hmm. Lauren, they did it over.
Yeah. Right.
Sometimes when I hear it, I go, "Is that the one?" Oh no, that's not it.
Right.
Yep. Warren G.
I have to say, funny story. One year, the WNBA on TNT, they used it. It was their logo.
Mm-hmm. Sure was.
Their theme song. And the other young lady who sang with me, Allison Williams, she called me. She said, "Girl, they using this song, and I'm negotiating with them. And we got paid."
Good.
Yeah. Nice.
It's still not what we were worth, but
yeah.
they did a whole. It was like for whatever at that time the WNBA was fairly new. So mm-hmm. whenever they would be on TV, they would play. We're playing that. And there's also a game, like a video game.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We're trying to get the money from them for a minute.
Nice.
You know. So okay. The thing is, they make you prove it. They kind of make you, you know, like that's what they used to do with our union, SAG-AFTRA. If there was a dispute and someone said, "That's my voice," or "So-and-so kept mm-hmm. my voice on it," they would make you go up to the union and you'd have to prove that you sang it.
You'd have to sing it?
Yeah, they would. Wow. Say, there have been times when I've done backgrounds on a record and mm-hmm. the producer would say, "The artist is struggling with these three lines. Can you just sing listen to the verse, and I need you to just sing a couple of lines." And next thing you know, you're singing one line, then you're singing two lines, and you sing the verse, and you hear the record, and you're like, "You kept my voice on this mm-hmm.
sing."
Really?
Yeah. So that's the whole thing. That's what Martha was saying.
Oh yeah, it's a lot of it's. Oh, it's so
that much. Is exactly what Martha was saying. Martha said she
Martha, never. We were so happy when Martha got when Martha got baby, because I sang on that. I work with CNC too.
Okay.
Factory on a lot of their stuff. Yeah, I did demos for them too. The demo for what's the little girl? The girl who was the face of the group. I did her demos as well.
Oh, okay.
David would have me sing the demo because there are singers that there are people who can sing a little bit, but they don't have the what's the word? I'm looking at? The creativity mm-hmm. to come up with a melody or how to
or run
or phrasing. Yeah.
So they would hire us singers and we would do the demo, get paid to do the demo,
and then they
go home, they listen to it for like a week or two, and then they repeat every that's what between mm-hmm. you and me, French Jolie, gonna get over you. I mm-hmm. I did the whole she copied everything. I mm-hmm. It's fine. I don't when you're young and you're starving, I'll do it. Sure, you can do the demo, but after a while it starts to burn, like
no doubt.
Mm-hmm.
Especially
mm-hmm.
if they're copying your flavor, your style, you're like, "I'm not doing demos no more. I'm gonna stop doing demos."
Right. So eventually it gets, and I bet you it gets under your skin if somebody comes up to you and says, "You know, you sound like that one girl."
Yeah.
I made that girl style, but okay.
When I'm in the car, sometimes I forget, like, "Oh, that's right. I did the demo. Like, why do I know every little part of this?"
It's right.
Like,
mm-hmm. Oh,
yeah.
I did it. Right.
Chris Jasper.
My mother's like, there's a book in you. She said, "You need to write it." My mother used to say that.
She's right.
She's right about that.
Mm-hmm.
You need to write a book.
Yes, you do.
Be a waiting for it.
Come on, Ryan. Me and you. Come on.
Let's go. I could do it. Send me some cliff notes.
You know what? She thinks I'm playing. I'm dead.
Listen, Audrey, I will send you my email. Mm-hmm.
Look, if Ryan can't do it, I'm going to sit down with AI and I'll do it with you.
No, I'm going to help you, bro.
Yeah, the answer.
There's so much about the industry that is so hidden.
Yeah.
It's not all dark, but if you've not experienced it, you don't know. Yeah. How things are going, you know, right. You just don't know. Now I have one request. Can I ask a question? I'm about to lose juice on my.
Oh.
I need to get a new
your device. Yeah.
A plug. No, just a plug.
Okay. You do that, and we are going to. I'm gonna play this commercial again. How about that?
How about that?
Make my client happy one more time.
Turn it down a scotch.
Turn it down a bit. Yeah. See, I can't do that on my end. Let's see what happens here. Let's go.
Berkeley, get ready for the legendary Incognito, now featuring Mesa. Sunday, April 7th at Freight and Salvage in downtown Berkeley. Two shows at 6 and 8:30. Incognito with Mesa. With special guests Annie Chantel. Get tickets at thefreight.org and coolrhythmandgrooves.com. Incognito and Mesa live.
Comes in hot. I got no control over it. They say it's running the spot.
It does. It's like, oh.
That's a classic radio spot. Let's come in with
it. Yeah, it is. That didn't got me that though.
This is how they used to do radio all the time. Then 50 Cent did it with the shotgun and explosions. And I know we're running short on time, but I had to ask her. I don't know if she, are you back?
I'm back. Yeah.
So you did a duet with Omar Chandler.
Yes.
So from the DJ side, Omar Chandler is like a mythic hero to us, you know.
Wow.
Because the stuff that he did with any rest in peace, Omar Chandler.
Right,
but
right. Rest in
the
peace.
Stuff what he did with Rob Bass was just phenomenal.
So the weird thing about him and I, he was a fan of Unlimited Touch. Mm. So whenever we would the person that I was dating at the time brought him around and he wanted to be an artist. And he was this hyper kid, like, oh my God, I love y'all. And he was So years later, he did the Rob Bass thing. It blew up for him. He got a solo deal. And they called me and they said, Rob, he wants you to sing backgrounds on some other song on the album. And we're in there singing it. And then, you know, everybody's leaving. And he's like, I want to do this duet and I want you to do it. And I was like, what? I wasn't even prepared. It was a session, a background session. I said, so I stayed and we did this never in a million years. That's one of those songs that she talked about. Not to say I didn't think anyone would hear it, but it was a remake of a Brainstorm song. So I was just like, ain't no way this is going to do better than the original. I mean, I love the original. And I'll never forget the first time I did Soul Train was with him. It was on Mother's Day. I got called. I had to go out to California. I did Soul Train. I did the Apollo with him. And, you know, it's because he looked at me as his sister and he wanted me to be a part of it. So it was a session that I sang the backgrounds on it. And then he said, I need you to sing the lead. And I said, do what? Hmm. And so we had to stay there all night singing it. I think I came back and listened to it and fixed a few of the parts. But yeah, Omar is a sweet man. And the way he passed was really unfortunate, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he was so young.
Yeah, God, he was in his, was he even 30?
I was going to say 38, something like that.
It was
out. I mean, I read about it and, you know, a lot of people were not hip to him as much, the people that I talked to. But, you know, it was a few people that knew and I was just like, oh my God, tragic. I guess he was down south, he went back. It's just unfortunate.
It's heartbreaking.
So Ryan, look, this is what I was charging my, I don't know if you can see it.
Yeah, oh, it's sparkly.
Really, really cute. It don't work.
Lesson learned.
It wasn't charging my pen. No, ma'am.
It's pretty though. Just put it on a necklace.
Put it into the wall.
Going in the garbage.
There you go. Useless.
Now you brought up Martha Wash. You know Jeannie Tracy?
Jeannie Tracy, yeah, our good friends on social media. Yeah.
Yeah, nice. She's been on the show. She's right here in the Bay Area as well. We had a lot of fun with her. She was just she's just a joyous person. And she doesn't get interviewed a whole lot, she was saying. And we made her laugh. We told some stories with her, but she said to tell you hello.
Oh, please.
I hope she's watching tonight. So if she's not, I'm gonna make sure I send her the link after we're done. But she definitely said to tell you hello. Melba on the show and she watches us pretty much every week. I'm surprised she hasn't watched
it yet. Yeah, whatever. Look at this cat. What the hell?
we can smell the brute. We can smell the group through the computer.
We smelled you coming.
Great flannel, baby. Great flannel.
That's right. Lean back so we can see the soap on the rope.
No comment.
No comment is a comment.
We ain't talking jail talk.
I don't know. You got that Nets shirt on it. That is jail talk.
Yeah.
Oh.
They asked me about my team. Are you a Knicks fan?
Hell, Nets, baby.
I'm a Knicks.
N-E-T.
Yeah, but he got the Nets. The Nets. That Nets shirt is equivalent to jail talk right now.
Oh, he said jail talk right now. He said
Nets
is better than Nets.
They were talking about the Nets.
Have one. You need better security in there. You need better security in that room, Audrey.
There you go.
I need better security in this room.
Well,
ask him if he had any salmon tonight.
Did he tell y'all about that? What did he tell
them? Salmon.
You have some salmon?
We mess around and we say it all the time. And out the street, people are like, do they know that's the wrong way to say it?
When he was on the show, I had a salmon, according to him, a salmon colored shirt and jacket.
Yeah, jacket, baby. Yeah. It was a shirt jacket, it was a shacket.
Oh my God.
Y'all crazy.
A shirt jacket. A shacket.
Right.
Jacket.
Oh my gosh, my face is hurting.
You guys are crazy. Bye. Go finish your salmon.
Oh, salmon. She said, finish your salmon. We had salmon last night.
Did you? Okay. Well, okay.
We had salmon. Not salmon. Oh, my God.
Well, we just got a few more minutes with you, Audrey. Okay. So we want to finish strong with your girl, Shaka. I know you've been touring with Shaka for 30 plus years.
Oh, 30,
so that means that our paths have crossed many times because I've seen Shaka so many times, I had no idea you were back there. But
oh, yeah, I'm in the middle. Always in the middle.
Okay. It's kind of hard to get Shaka when I'm in my radio days. It was hard to get Shaka to do a little meet and greet. So she wasn't feeling it. So.
Oh, yeah. She's like 50 years in this industry. She's like that. Listen, just a trick to tell y'all. Frankie wanted her to do the whole tour. And she was like, nope. I'll do two. So we did last week and we're doing Chicago in April. And that's it. We're all like, please ask her because it's really a nice package.
It's got to be sold out everywhere you go.
I couldn't get any guests. Yeah, it's a nice.
Can she still play drums?
Yes, she can. Absolutely.
Okay.
And timbales.
Okay, so
she mostly does that. They bring out timbales and they have them.
Mm-hmm. Oh wow.
I know you. I live you. We do that.
Yeah,
they bring it out and she'll play. Yeah.
Wow.
I know you.
Yeah. So when we do next time you're in town, we're gonna do a meet and greet with you.
Please.
With you.
I'll get you back.
I just want to be nice. I don't want her to be, you know, upset that I'm back. I want to be nice.
She won't be.
Don't hit her with the Shaka Khan. Shaka Khan, don't do that.
No.
Did you tell her?
Right.
No, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that.
I'm surprised
y'all don't do Gotta Be There. I love her version of that.
So the thing is, we've never done that live. The thing that's funny is different regions like different things. So like when we go to the islands, they like Everywhere.
Yeah.
When we go to England, we did Higher Love, which we don't do a lot. Mm-hmm. We do it actually. And so it depends on where we have to go. You know, so like we're doing an orchestral thing at the Hollywood Bowl with so she's gonna do like I Love You Porgy. It's gonna be some
Wow.
There you go.
Yeah, so she's just like
okay.
We have to remember that we love doing the songs, but she's over it.
Yeah. I get it. I get it.
We try to come up with, can we do any love? Can we do this? And she'll do it for maybe maybe two shows. The next thing we look down, it's off the set. We're like, darn it.
But yeah. her version of Got to Be There is just
amazing.
It is.
Her version of Gossamer Wings is amazing.
Oh, I remember that.
That's another one. That's a sleeper there.
God.
Wow.
Audrey, yeah. look that one up.
Till You Come Back to Me is the tribute to Aretha. Mm. Mm. I don't know if she recorded that, but we do it live, and we love doing it.
Mm-hmm. It's a great song.
Yeah, it is.
Her version of Night in Tunisia is my one, too.
Yes. We do that. So if you come to the show, we do that.
Okay.
All right.
We do that.
I go way back to I tell you this, I moved out of my parents' house in like 1980 or something like that. And I used to have this poster on my closet door, and my mama, bless her heart, she kept it up there for years and years and years. And I finally went back and took a razor blade and cut the scotch tape and took it up. And I folded it up. Now I have no idea where it is.
Oh.
Is it the poster that my brother had? Is it the one where she has on a pair of jeans and she's...
Yes.
That's the one.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
My brother had that too.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. So did my dad.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah. What a way to learn about someone.
Right. You know? Who is that lady?
why do you like?
Not my mom. Right.
You okay with this, mom?
Yeah. Right.
My brother had that up too. Yeah.
We had Bobby Watson on from Rufus.
Oh, I love Bobby.
Bobby was so funny because he could remember any of the things that he was doing back in the day.
Yeah, he's like, that's a nice song. Who played that? We're like, that's you.
You, Bobby.
Yeah, he's always talking about when I do see him. Occasionally, they get like us, the singers that sing with her, and they try to do a reunion thing. And they're like, yeah, would you go out there? I said, no, absolutely not. No, sir. And sometimes they have Malini, her daughter, do it. So
okay,
yeah, but like they try to get you guys know our music, yeah, but I'm not. They people want to hear Shaka Khan. They don't.
That's right, they do.
Right,
right.
Yeah, they're always reaching back to us. It's like
who is the drummer in the band now?
Now we have a guy named. I think I know why you're asking. We have a guy named JJ Williams. He's from DC, but we. Are you talking about someone from the past that we used to have?
Yeah, it's a young cat, and he's the
Ronald Bruner.
Yeah, he's the only person I've ever seen. Well, until I heard J Rod do it, but yeah, he's the only person who I saw play the drum beat for 777 by the time.
That's right.
No, he's back.
That's right.
He's a. I want to say it the right way because I'm on the radio. He's a genius. He's a musical genius.
Yeah.
And played with Prince. He's played with George Duke.
Yeah. He's sometimes, the only person I've heard do it.
He's a bad boy. I'm not going to say he's not. Sometimes.
Yeah, we were in Napa for that, right?
People have to, you know,
really,
they go through their things. And he's one of those kids that we all love his playing. And just, you know, sometimes he's a lot. So it's like.
Yeah, I get that.
On the road is not always the best place, you know, sometimes for people to show that. But his solos are ridiculous. Even if you Google on. You go online, you'll see some of them where he's and there's one of us in Amsterdam to concert. I want to say it's from 2017, maybe. It's a great concert.
Say his name again.
His name is Ronald Bruner, B-R-U-N-E-R. He comes from a musical family. His dad and his brother plays bass, I think. He's a bad boy. And play with a lot of people.
Mm. Yeah, I think CJ, I think you're right. I think that was Napa.
Napa, yeah.
Because we were at Soundcheck in Napa and he started doing something that was similar to that.
Yeah.
And I stopped and I said, hey, man, can you do this? And he just turned around and laid it out.
Yeah.
At Blue Note?
No, we were at Brian Culberson's.
Miss Audrey, we've worked together over the years and haven't even really.
You know what? I was going to say that.
Yeah, we have.
Your name.
Yeah. We've worked, you know, because every time. Chaka comes to town, you're with her. So we've done the Berklee Jazz Festival, Brian Culberson's Jazz Getaway in Napa, Stone Soul Concert. So yeah, we've been in proximity, just never really met.
Didn't sound familiar, and someone just posted a link to Ronald Bruner.
Yeah, shout out to Stephanie. She's been very resourceful today.
Stephanie. Yeah.
Thank you, Stephanie.
That's our Stephanie. Family right there.
She's the bomb. We just got a couple more minutes with you, so we did want to play some Shaka stuff, and
I'm gonna
let CJ Flash do his thing. Go, Flash. Now, here's the obvious question. Do you have a favorite Chaka song that you love to sing or you love to hear her sing? How about that?
You just played one of them. Ain't Nobody. What you're gonna do for me is my
favorite.
Okay.
I love it. The stuff that I love, we're not doing. Like, I like Any Love.
Oh, God.
Keep trying to get her to do it, but and I like Till You Come Back to Me. Mm-hmm. And I like I'm Every Woman. I do.
It's
kind of a kitschy, but because the funny thing is I also sang on the Whitney version as well.
Oh, wow.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. So it's just like full circle, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Come up with the Chaka Khan at the end. Whose idea was it to come up with that whole Chaka Khan when he's saying that again?
Our MD. Yeah,
oh, okay.
And then, you know, on Ain't Nobody, the whole band does this dip. You know, I'm sure Jerry does. See, I know Jerry probably knows it. The whole band does this thing. So that's like the last number.
Nice.
So how do you campaign for songs? You campaign to the MD, or you guys just sit there in a room and say, we'd like to hear this or we want to play this?
It's actually more her. We have to get her to do it because we all, like our MD he knows all her stuff. And so he'll send it to us and say, y'all remember this song? And so we'll put it on the set list, we'll rehearse it. And then we're all like this, like, and then she'll see it and say, oh, who put this on here?
You sound just like her too.
We ain't doing that.
I didn't do that. Oh God,
it's all good.
Beauty and Chaka.
Yeah. How long have you been working with her?
I started working with her in 1990, so 34 years.
Wow, that's wow. Right. Wow,
she said, I heard you do my voice. Let me hear you do it. I was like,
yeah, you got it down.
Well, you talk just like her.
I mess the band up sometimes. Like if I'm off stage and I have her mic. I'll say, like, how you doing out there?
And they're like, oh, we better get it together.
They get nervous.
We're late.
Yeah.
You play jokes on the band in the in-ears?
Well, actually, on her mic. Because we test her sound. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, if they're all looking down, I'll say it just like her. And they all look up, like, oh, she here for real? They go, oh, come on, man, don't do that. Yeah, only time she comes is, like, TV shows. When we did the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, she came to sound it. Yeah, you got it on his TV.
Yeah.
So you're telling us we have no chance of getting her on IRTSI?
I'm not saying that.
Yeah, you kind of did. Yeah, you kind of did.
How about we blur my face, and then I no, I'm just
like, yeah, exactly.
well, you know, when we had Jesse on last week, we had his picture up there.
It could have been anybody.
I'm not sure if it was Jesse or not. I think it was.
It could have been you doing Jesse Johnson.
You know what? I was just thinking that.
Yeah, so
that's funny.
Maybe we shouldn't say that out loud just in case. No, but
yeah, but you have to have lava rocks in the background.
Yeah, right. That's exactly.
Yeah, I'm sorry, bourbon and lava rocks.
Right. That's exactly.
Is that what he had?
Oh,
yeah. Well,
he doesn't drink. But he doesn't drink at all, but he was replanting something, and it really sounded like.
It sounded like this.
Oh, what?
And I said, what are you doing, bro? He said, oh, I'm just replanting.
I'm replanting.
I've had plenty of Henny Coke. That sounds like you put some ice in that glass.
He didn't have his face on the screen at all.
Not at all.
He didn't want to.
Wow. But he's playing here.
Yeah, we're gonna go see him. I'm gonna go see him next weekend. He'll be here. Yeah. So I think we're gonna go see him.
So he can't have a filter then. So no.
I don't know. He might have his back to the audience like Miles Davis or something, maybe.
Oh god.
Rochelle Pharrell.
Miles is very Shaka has a lot of stories about Miles. Oh my god. Yeah, love Shaka.
Well, look, we have to let you go now because we've had you for a lot longer than we thought we would. And just to let you know that this has been a real thrill for me.
Thank you.
Just listening to all your stories and all, people need to find out more about Audrey Wheeler Downing. Yeah. She has got a career. She's got a book or two inside of her. She can tell you about roller skating. She can tell you about.
I crochet too. I make stuff on my social media page. Yep.
Did you design that room? Because the room is fabulous behind you. Did you do that too?
Oh, thank you. Mr. Downing has a lot to do with it.
Okay, I love that blue paint. It's gorgeous.
Oh, thank you. No, that was, but the pictures, the artwork is my husband. He's
well
amazing.
Done.
Yeah. Well, talk about the crochet. Your social media, where can they find it?
It's selling by Audrey _ crochet designs.
Okay.
It's also, you can go to my regular page on Instagram and you'll see it. But I do hats and sweaters and I haven't been doing a lot lately because I've been busy, but it's a great stress reliever when you're traveling.
Is that where Kyle Newport gets those sweaters from?
I haven't met Kyle yet.
I was going to say, is that where Kyle got his mustache from? Is it
You wonder how funny that is. Did you crochet Kyle's mustache? That's so funny. She crocheted his mustache.
Got you, Kyle.
Jerry, you have no idea how funny
that was.
That's
a great one, she does.
She crocheted his mustache.
Oh, my God.
You'll never live it down.
No, I don't blame you. Ever.
He's on the show.
No.
All right, really quickly, let's go around the horn and say our final goodbyes to Miss Audrey Wheeler Downing. How about D Minor while we serve with you, bro?
Well, I just want to say thank you so much for just coming on the show. And this has been a treat for me. Just a well-rounded show. We were just talking about the business of music. Right. And obviously, and then just in celebrating you, it's truly amazing. So thank you so much.
Did you guys notice
he lowered his voice a little bit when he started talking?
I noticed. He got all sexy.
He went down.
I thank you for your knowledge. You're on it. You really very. I see why they call you what they call you. Thank you.
Brown Tanica. Okay.
Thank you,
Ryan Nicole.
It's always a joy for me to sit with legends in this game, and particularly Black women who are making things happen and have made things happen and have longevity. It's such a joy to sit with a woman who is a wife and a mother and still holding her artistry down. So you drop so many gems and I'm soaking them all up and, you know, eager to get with you on writing that book or just nudge you and tell you to make it happen.
For
yeah.
Real. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you. Great, Ryan. Big, thank you.
Big Russ.
And Audrey, it is so I've known you through other people for many, many years. It's really, really nice. Will is a good friend of mine. It's nice to meet the better half virtually here. And I hope to meet you in person soon.
I do.
But you are the soundtrack of so many records that I play. And the way people react to your voice and the records. I will tell you what, CJ is not going to ever tell you this, but he plays Funky Sensation every event.
Oh my God.
Every event. Like it's his theme song.
I concur.
There's a clip of me on TikTok cutting Funky Sensation up, really.
Oh, I would love to hear it. Oh, my gosh.
All right, Flash, your turn, Flash. You got the mic.
You have no idea, like, to echo what Russ just said, to learn that you were singing on that was like, And so, you know, we have these records, and some of them were just 12 inches, and we didn't get a chance to read liner notes because that's they didn't have any, you know.
Right.
And to find out that you have been on so many of them, it just brings a joy to my heart to
thank you so much.
And I'm really, really excited about this book that's coming out. I'm really excited.
Oh, it's coming out. Me and Ms. Ryan, we don't.
I'm saying.
Seriously. I have a big idea. I promise you. For real. Get my email for me.
All right, well, I will just finish it off by saying that thank you again so much. We really appreciate it. Again, like Ryan was saying, what everybody was saying, it's great to hear the people behind the scenes that are really making all the noise. Because as you probably know, there's probably people know more of the background singers' words than they do the lead singers' words. And we end up singing your words all the time.
Right.
And the fact that you're Miss Black America, I think that's really cool. When I was a young kid, that was big back when I was a kid.
That was big.
And that was a big deal. So that's definitely something you should be very proud of. And who knew? I'm going to go out and buy me some Old Spice tomorrow morning.
Or some Brute.
Brute by Fabergé.
By Fabergé. Thank you, guys.
Thank you so much. CJ Flash, you want to take us home?
Yeah, I think I'm going to do that. I'm going to think I'm going to do that.
Good night, everybody. You go out every night as a singer, but you don't really know what to do. You see someone that you'd like to mingle and imagine that she is waiting for you.
IRTS Live is brought to you by CDove HR Consulting Group, the human resources specialist, providing personalized service to building a better tomorrow. Enjoy the difference. Lifelong Medical Care, offering free vaccines for everyone 12 and over. Call Lifelong at 510-549-5454 or visit lifelongmedical.org. Check out gdovedesigns.com to get t-shirts and hoodies that make a statement. Join DJs Big Russ and CJ Flash for the world-famous show live Fridays, noon to 4 Pacific. Catch them on the following social media platforms. And if you'd like to join us as a sponsor, please email us at info@irtsshow.com.